Thank you, Kubasu. Thank you, the AFC organizing team, for getting us here. Greetings to everybody who has joined. I believe you can all hear me. Maybe you can use the chat just to confirm that we can be heard, we can be seen. Looking forward to having a very good session as we discuss best practices to access to market. Thank you. Thank you. Fantastic. Fantastic that you can hear us. I'll quickly introduce the session. As Wangeshi had mentioned earlier, we're talking about access to markets. And this session really will be understanding what are the challenges, what are the roadblocks, but still, what are the best practices that we have done in our markets? What are those strategies and opportunities that exist for us to take home and implement within our organization? My name is Kate Nkatha. I'm the commercial director at Fairtrade Africa. I have sold most of my life, actually, from selling chocolate in my earlier days to selling media and health products, mosquito nets, and you name it. So I'm really happy to be working here with the farmers and really doing a very purposeful job or role here at Fairtrade. So quite excited to be here. Feel free to keep using the chat function. I shall be picking up a few questions and I shall invite some of you to ask questions as we go along. But as we begin, allow me to introduce our panelists. We have panelists from across the world. Kubasu, if you could put up the presentation. And even as I introduce them, they will come and say hello in their language, just to give you a flavor of how wide our conference is. All right, that's good. I shall start with Marina. Marina is the communication manager or the head of communication at Wines of South Africa. So really the leading organization body at South Africa that markets wines for all the wine producers in South Africa. She has had great exposure in wine marketing, and she even has certification in small scale winemaking from University of Stellenbosch. She's very passionate about communication and the role that it has in opening up markets. So welcome, Marina. Please say hello in your native language. Marina is calling from South Africa.
Good afternoon, everybody, and a very warm welcome to this session from Stellenbosch in the heart of the winelands here in the Western Cape.
Thank you. Welcome. Next, we have Nemlin. Nemlin is one of our producers in Ivory Coast in the cocoa value chain, but he also does rubber. He's one of the administrators of CADESA Cooperative, and he also is the contact person with both internal and external partners. So our buyers and our visitors that we take to Ivory Coast are received by Nemlin. Nemlin, how do you say hello in French? I think as he gets his sound up to speed, we also have Benitez all the way from El Salvador, from Cooperativa Los Pinos. I hope I pronounced that right. He has 20 years experience.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, thank you. He has 20 years experience in coffee production. And he has been in charge of coffee commercialization, really managing the crop and promoting coffee as a tourism, coffee farming as a tourism opportunity for El Salvador. So we'll hear a lot about the small producer organization and access to market for coffee, both in North America and Europe. Welcome, Benitez. How do you say hello in Spanish?
Hello, nice to meet you.
Okay, good. I thought you'd speak in Espanol. Right, then we have Ms. Hend. Ms. Hend is joining us from Egypt. Ms. Hend is the Quality and Corporate Affairs Director at Daltex Corporation, a big, really organization that is in the front running objectives, delivering quality products, mainly in fruits and vegetables in Egypt and serving many markets across the world. Ms. Hend also is responsible for corporate relations with many organizations like the UN Global Impact, the Ministries of Education and Trade for the organization, and many others, and all the sustainability matters and objectives of the organization are led by Ms. Hend. Ms. Hend, welcome to this session. Say hello in Arabic or whichever language you prefer.
Hello everyone. اهلا بيكم بالعربي وسعيدة ان انا اكون معاكم. I'm happy to be with you. Thank you.
Fantastic. Thank you. And all the way from Germany, we have Jens Kramer. He's one of our big buyers and traders who've been buying flowers from our Kenyan farms like Flamingo, who I believe are on the call. And he's a third generation working in the flower farm, and he does distribution of flowers and vegetables in the UK, in the Netherlands and Germany. So a lot of experience in terms of flower marketing and access to markets in the north. He shall be telling us what we need to look out for. Welcome, Jens. How do you say hello in German? Right.
Okay,
all right. Thank you. And then in a few minutes, we'll be joined by Nicholas Lambert, who is the CEO of Fairtrade Belgium. And he'll be telling us some of the things that the buyers are looking for in the north. What can we as producers do, improve or do differently to be able to capture more markets? So without further ado, let us begin this conversation, and we shall begin with Ms. Hend. And Ms. Hend, please tell us about quality. What is the value of quality in access to markets? And how does that, how do our producers, what are the challenges have you faced in your organization, and what, how can we overcome those?
Yes, hi, hello everyone. Quality is actually the main factor. It's allowing you to penetrate markets and allowing you to, allowing us as producers to sell quality products, whether it's fair trade or non-fair trade, to big supermarkets and European markets, Asian markets, Russian, and so on. Each customer and each country has its own quality requirements and specifications. And to be able to follow these specifications and to fulfill the requirements, that's how you enter the market. You just enter the market because you're satisfying their needs and hopefully working on exceeding their expectations, because that's how you can sustain your business with such clients. So that's the thing about quality, and you have to ensure everything from good agricultural practices in the field, how you use the chemicals, the pesticides, the fertilizers, and so on, how you use the water itself, how to sustain it, how to minimize the use of water using new techniques and new methods. It goes into how to prepare the crop for harvest, how to harvest the quality crop itself, and to have, you know, different different times to harvest. Like, for example, at the moment we have the grapes season. It's a very high season, very demanding, very short. You work all year, 12 months for 45 days of harvest, packing, and shipping. And if you miss something in this 45 days, all your efforts and money is gone for the whole year. So you have to work all year round with over 20 different technical aspects of handling the crop in order to prepare it for harvest. And when you harvest the quality, the cleaning of the crop itself, and then you go to the packhouse, how you transport it from the packhouse to from the field to the packhouse, and then how you handle it in the packhouse in good atmosphere, airing, hygienic place, the hygiene of the labor of the packers. Most of the packers, as you know, in packhouses are women. And that because they are more meticulous, they are more into details. The you follow up with them, you train them on a daily basis, just short training on the job, what to look for, how to handle the crop, how to handle the bunch of grapes, for example. Or if we're working with potatoes or oranges or whatever, it's the same thing. It's how you handle the crop and how you pack it according to specs. Because for you can have in one pack house, 3, 4, 5 lines of packing lines. Each is packing in a different packing material, different qualities to different clients. So you have to be, I mean, managing this pack house is very important. You have to take care of all details. And then continuing the quality, you have to check the raw materials coming in. You have to check the online, and final check is of the final pallet. The crop inside the pallet, meeting the specs or not, taking an average, everything. It comes to sugar, to size, to, you know, how it looks like. The packing itself is the proper packing for the that client, specific client, and so on. So that's how you handle quality. And then you go to the, for example, if it's grapes, you go to the pre-coolers, and then from the cooling to the cooling chamber of the cold store, and then you ship into reefer containers going to the clients. Mm-hmm. So it's a bit detailed thing, but that's, we have quality checks and monitoring on each step to secure make sure that everything is going right as much as possible. Nothing is 100% in the world, yes, but we're trying to reach over 95-97% so that we can satisfy our clients, taking into consideration that we are handling very perishable crops. It's not it needs a lot of handling. So that's the important thing about quality. If we come into challenges, over the years, I mean, we've been certified with Fairtrade since 2011. And even before that, Fairtrade came in and we went for it because it meets a lot of what we are preaching in the market. And to actually combat the agricultural norms in the country, whether it's Egypt where we're working or any other African company, there are a lot of agricultural norms, like the young people working, children working, for example, in the fields. You don't allow this, but how can you combat it? So we have to come up with innovative solutions to do that. One of the innovations we did is that we're having contracts with specific clauses and agreement with the labor contractors. For example, that you don't bring anybody under 16 or 15 to work in the field. Nobody under 18 ever to work in the pack house. We make sure of that. We look at their IDs. And if, of course, the labor contractors, you know how manipulative they are. So they bring young people, they say they can't afford to go to school. So what we've taken the out of the box solution, we went to all the community, small communities and villages around us, and we pay the school tuition and school fees for these kids so that they can stay in school. They can come afterwards. They can come in the summer and get training and short days to work and to get some income because they are poor families. So we're doing this and in that area. If we come into women, women also had a problem, and women were only seasonal for harvest or packing. You don't have most of the agribusiness for the last decade when we started hiring, where we've always been hiring women, but it was seasonal. But what we did on a different thing is to have the full gender equality, let's say what, system incorporated in our operations. How we do that? We are hiring women directly, not through a contractor. We're giving them a safe environment. We're giving them safe transport. We're renting a bus for them in each area to bring them from their villages to the pack house or to the farm. Safely, if the villages, for example, or their men in the back in the villages. Trade that their women are going to do is that we hire a man from their village to be their escort. He's hired full time as they are. We gave them work contracts, labor contracts for 12 months. So, and we created jobs for them. Even though we don't have harvest or packing, we let them work in the fields. We train them on all technical operations for the crops so that they can have work all year round and they are directly hired with all the benefits. Social security, they have it. They have the contracts, they have the medical. Insurance, they have the transport, as I said. What we did also is that only training the women on technical, but also on communications, on how to handle harassment. And we train the men and the supervisors in the fields and in the pack houses how to work together as a team, how to communicate with women, how to avoid any harassment, even words, because the culture is. Have a loud voices and shouting and do this and do that. No, we have to cooperate. Let them explain, let them know, train them, and then you expect them. And the rewards have been really good. The results have been very good. And since we did
allow me to interject.
Sure.
Allow me to interject, Ms. Hend. Thank you. Thank you really for even outlining the importance of delivering quality products and consistently. So it does have a big role to play in accessing the market. And the investment you're putting in the youth, in the women, it only makes sense for you to retain them, even when you have no harvest and you have the same skill, you know, and there's no additional costs in terms of training.
They accumulate the skills, yes.
They accumulate the skills. And you're leaving the community actually much, much better. And all these really are able to help you tell a good story as you're selling your products and locking markets. So going all the way to El Salvador, Benitez, how do you ensure that you're delivering great quality that of course are guided by some of the standards that we have? And Ms. Hend has talked quite a bit on them on the human rights, the standards, the climate issue. What are the things in terms of quality, any challenges that you face or any other that you may have faced to increase access to market? But first, tell us, where do you sell your coffee and what kind of coffee do you produce in El Salvador for unsold and fair trade terms?
Okay. Thank you very much. I'm going to speak Spanish. Primero, agradecer la oportunidad que me brindan para poder estar compartiendo con ustedes esta bonita experiencia. Quería comentar primeramente, nosotros somos...
Just a moment, Benitez, for the audience. Okay. For those who are not speaking French, I hope our French interpretation is working. If you go to the bottom of your screen on the globe, click on it and you'll find a French interpretation. So you speak on, click on Spanish click on Spanish if you'd like to follow Benitez. Go ahead.
Okay. Quería hacer énfasis, nosotros estamos produciendo café arábica, producimos en El Salvador. Nosotros somos una cooperativa que estamos en el occidente del país y por las condiciones que tenemos también hemos incursionado en el turismo para hacer esa combinación de café con turismo. Quería el acceso al mercado de café comercio justo se va haciendo cada vez más difícil. Y hay diferentes factores en los cuales pudiéramos mencionar. Y el primero de ellos, hay que decirlo, y es la sobreoferta de café certificado comercio justo. Tenemos una sobreoferta en el cual muchas cooperativas no les permite poder tener vender su café bajo el sello comercio justo. Por otro lado, también es importante dentro de la misma sello de comercio justo, también exige calidad. Y hay muchos productores que no están preparados para poder darle esa calidad que el mercado está exigiendo. Por lo tanto, es importante que podamos entender que si las organizaciones de pequeños productores y para poder incursionar al mercado de comercio justo, va a ser bien difícil tener ese café de comercio justo. Por otro lado, también es importante hacer de los pequeños productores y dentro de las organizaciones de pequeños productores no participar en ferias, poder darse a conocer con los compradores, poder hacer enlaces, poder hacer...
Excuse me, Benitez. Apologies, we're having a challenge with the interpretation. We're having a challenge with the interpretation. Let them work in the back end to try and get the interpretation sorted. Then you can continue, unless you're able, you're comfortable speaking in English.
Okay. I will try to speak English, okay? Yes. I said that one of the big challenge the organization or a small producer is to access, you know, to access to the market because of the oversupply. You know, we have oversupply in the fair trade seal. So I think it's very difficult for those organizations that don't have the resources, you know, to participate in some coffee shop or some fairs, you know, in USA or Europe and other countries. So they need, you know, to other organizations, you know, to show their coffee. So it's very difficult for them. But also, I think it's not just to have the fair trade seal, you know, that you also need to improve the quality of the coffee. Mm-hmm. Also because most of the buyer, they are asking for a good quality, or that they don't know what kind of coffee they have, you know. So it's very important to improve the quality. And also, so I think that there are other problems that most organizations or the small organizations don't have an opportunity to improve the techniques, you know, how to improve quality or how to access to the market. So it's very important for the fair trade office in the different consumers countries that to help, you know, these organizations. And I think to promote more, it's very important to do that. So I can have the opportunity to help other small produce growers, you know, to access the market because they don't have the resources to do that.
Thank you.
I think it's a
Thank you, Benitez, and he stresses the point again, just like Ms. Hand, about
science.
Quality being extremely important, and the investments that you have to put to ensure that you're able to deliver that investment. But in terms of accessing market, Benitez, why is there such a big difference in terms of accessing fair trade markets and conventional markets? And in your opinion, what can we really do, especially for the coffee value chain, where we are selling about 25% of our produce on fair trade? In your opinion, how can we then keep increasing that so that at least we're able to sell 70, if not 100% of our coffee on fair trade terms?
Well, in my opinion, I think that we need to promote more the coffee in the consumer countries, you know, because is that we don't have too much consumers, you know, to buy our coffee, is going to be difficult to for the whole organization to sell at least 75%, you know, for their coffee. But also I think that it's very important that the organizations can know about the market, because if I don't know what kind of coffee I have, it's going to be difficult to promote my coffee. So I think this is very important. But in the conventional market, you know, they don't pay too much. Even, you know, some buyers, they buys, you know, for some organization to sell me in the conventional market. That is something that is happening right now.
Okay. Thank you for that. And yes, it's really a challenge in addition to fair trade to again look at the coffee consuming markets, as you've said. Like Finland, they consume about 12 kilos of coffee per year per person. You have your Canada, your Norway, all these countries that are also part of the fair trade movement. Netherlands, that will continue really marketing our coffees to ensure that we are able to get that. Even as we grow and communicate about sustainable supply chain, sustainable trade, and sustainable consumption. And of course, it's a flip as coffee markets are changing in terms of size in the north, is also to look at the south. You probably have tell us if there are any opportunities within South America or even in Africa. We'll talk about that later in terms of consumption of coffee. And of course, it's change of behavior, exactly. Like you look at markets like Africa, where we're very used to taking black tea. Yes, so again, following the need and being able to deliver the consumer needs is one of the key aspects of accessing markets. So let's switch over again to something sweet like wine. Mariana, please tell us, how is communication and marketing of wine? What are the challenges you faced? But most importantly, what are the strategies you have executed that could be borrowed and be implemented across other value chains like cocoa, coffee as well? As you can see, we need to sell a lot more coffee than we are. And we'll also hear about flowers later, but hey, let's talk about some wine.
Wine is always an exciting subject, well, for me anyway. Kate, yes, I think South Africa produces roughly 2/3 or even almost 3/4 of all the fair trade wine that is available around the world. So it is a very important and viable way for us to really do business, and hopefully we'll see even more growth. We do know that especially our European markets, which is our largest export market, really values the fair trade mark and see the importance of creating viable projects for the betterment of South African people via the sale of wine. I do believe that fair trade has given a number of opportunities to people on South African wine farms, all the way through to the children that live as part of the communities in the families, all the way up to workers who've lived and worked on these farms quite often for generations. And this is a very important focus for us. Sustainability is really where the buck stops for the South African wine industry. And that sustainability not only ends with our people, but also our planet and the long-term prosperity of the South African wine industry. And this is really where fair trade speaks to what we are doing, certainly in the long term. The projects that have helped grow the community in all of the various areas where fair trade is active has really gone a long way to establish future growth opportunities. And what we're seeing now is that international buyers, especially from Europe, as I mentioned earlier, are really asking the question from our producers whether they are fair trade certified. And this is enabling them through the minimum pricing to really position themselves. One of the big challenges that we have here as the South African wine industry is with pricing. And through the fair trade minimum pricing, it really is helping our producers quite a lot.
Apologies for that, I was muted. Definitely, Mariana. And I'm happy to say we are also trying to make very good headways. We're currently about to sign a deal with one of a new trader in Ivory Coast, selling South African wine, because what we have noticed is a lot that is going into West Africa, but we're trying to get as much as fair trade labeled products as possible. So there's a lot of opportunity. And it's amazing that even during, despite the COVID pandemic, the global sales of wine went up around 12%. But I guess it's because we're all indoors, we're consuming a lot more, we're drinking a lot more coffee, we are baking a lot more. That's why you see in some of the areas in the fair trade categories, the impact for 2020 wasn't as big because of just change in terms of consumption, either place, instead of going to a cafe, you still do your coffee at home and do that. So we hope we could get, we had a physical conference, we'll definitely be toasting at the Ngoma Awards with some fair trade wine. But please make sure you buy yourself some wine between now and Friday so that we can have a great Ngoma Awards over a glass of wine or a cup of tea or coffee. And so now, before we get into some flower talk, Nicolas is here. Welcome, Nicolas. Nicolas is our CEO for Belgium. He's a marketing guru, a professor in marketing, and has really great experience, decades having worked with companies that we strive to get access to, like Unilever and Heineken. And he's really doing a tremendous job in the banana and coffee, cocoa and sugar categories. Welcome, Nicolas. How do you say hello in your native language?
Well, I think hello is fine. Or bonjour, because we also speak French in Belgium.
Fantastic. Welcome. Please tell us, what challenges have you faced in sourcing products from the fair trade producers? And then also let us know what is it that we need to do as the system, fair trade system, and producers as well, to really increase access and meet the consumer needs and buyer needs.
Okay, yes, I think if we want to meet the buyers and consumer needs, of course we need to understand them. And what is of course complicated but also interesting is that not all our customers have the same needs. So if you sell to a coffee chain that is selling very high quality specialty coffee, for instance, then of course you will have to emphasize, you know, your cupping scores and your taste profile and these kind of things. Whereas if you sell to a company that is producing, you know, quite mainstream chocolate for daily consumption, maybe they will be less interested in purely the quality aspect of your product, although it needs to be good quality always. But they will be interested in other stories. So they might be very interested in, because it's a big company, in the whole area of human rights, for instance. And in that sense, it will be very important to show that you have good compliance with the standards. It will be very important to show that for instance, your cooperative is extremely well managed, is very well run, that it's working in a very democratic way, and so on. But on the other hand, if you stay in cocoa, you could work also with a producer of very fine delicacies in cocoa, and they will be looking for very specific profiles and taste attributes that will be important. So I think it's really important to understand that there is a very broad variety of customers and of needs. And of course, what I hope we will be able to do more and more is to help farmers really to also have a visibility of the supply chain, because the more visibility you have, the more information. And we all know that, of course, information is power. Right? So the more you know about your customers, the more you can emphasize really why you think that you are the best place to provide them your product according to what they will find important.
Sorry, apologies. I keep laughing at myself. It's been a year and a half, and at times I still forget to unmute. I'm sure a lot of you can feel me and understand that. So Peter from Ireland asks, how do we then reposition our argument as fair trade so that then we are able to get into more doors, Nicolas?
Sorry, I didn't quite get the question. How do we reposition or?
Yes, how do we requalify fair trade as compared to other specialties or direct trade coffee so that then we are able to get more customers? That's Peter from Fairtrade Ireland.
Yeah, my dear friend Peter. Well, again, I mean, you always have to start from the customers. And so it really depends on what they will need and they will find important. I think really my experience when talking to our customers here is that at the end of the day, you have some commonalities between different programs or certifications. You have Fair Trade, you have Fair Trade Alliance, you have some company programs, and some of the things are not that different. What I think is really setting us apart is really the emphasis on getting more money into the pockets of farmer, and not only having high demands in terms of compliance, but also making sure that there is a better distribution of value. And that makes us quite unique in being a real social justice actor in this sector, because a lot of people are telling you, I want you to follow lots of rules, but what are they giving you back actually? Whereas, you know, through fair trade, through the minimum price, through the high levels of premium, I think we are able to get farmers a better deal and what they really deserve at the end of the day. So that element for me of social justice through a good, a better deal is, I think, extremely important. And also, look, today we're all together and we're all represented, farmers, people from maybe the consuming countries in Europe or in America and so on. This inclusiveness, the fact that everyone in our organization is around the table, it's not a detail. It's extremely important. It's just not a system that is imagined in a capital in Europe or in the US by a big corporation, and that is imposed upon people. That is really something we are all building together for the benefits of the farmers. And I think that really typifies us a lot. And again, that makes it all the more credible to position us as this great movement for social justice.
Yes, indeed. And it would be good to hear now from Jens Kramer from Germany. He's been one of our big buyers from Germany in the flower sector. But I know they're also involved in the vegetable sector. So it would be good to hear from your perspective. What is it that you look for when you come and engage our buyers? So Jens has a 3-slide presentation that Kubasu is going to put up now. But there's a comment here from Lillian, as even as this presentation comes on, about producers. One of the challenges and one of the challenge we've been given is to really ensure that our producer profiles are very specific and really answering also the buyer needs. So that is one advice from Lillian. As you write your question, it would be good to write the country that you're from. It's amazing that we're from all parts of the world. Welcome, Jens, even as Kubasu puts up your presentation. Maybe you can begin as that comes on.
Yeah. Thank you. So it's not three, it's 6 pages, which is only one the cover page, if not Fairtrade has reduced it. But no, thank you very much for giving me the opportunity. Cut flower trade is a bit, and cut flower industry in this fair trade cosmos is a bit different to others, because as Nicola just said, mostly we are talking about farmers and cooperatives. But as you know, in textiles and in cut flowers, in wine, it also may be a bit different. We have investments from families, from investment funds, and then we have workers who benefit from the premium. And also the farmers and the investors, of course, benefit from what also Nicola said, continuous access to the market and so on. So what I would like to focus on is the momentum. It may sound a bit cynical in the times we are living in, with record numbers of refugees in the world, with still cruel wars, with COVID crisis not having reached even in the whole effect all areas of the world. But unfortunately, we need in times of crisis people who act and people who do something. And this is, I think, what we are. If we go to the next page, we are confronted with some of, I can do that. No, you have to do that. The next page, please. Whoever, the magic.
Kubasu has the magic wand.
Kubazu and I, this will not be the love forever. We have had our difficulties from the beginning. No. Kubazu? Okay, I can start. You don't have to see that. I can start even before you see the page there. Of course, there are certain challenges and roadblocks. We as speakers were also asked to put our attention on, because it doesn't make sense only to, let's say, to clap our shoulders and say how good we are. We are not alone in this world, and we are not acting independently. The climate crisis has reached all production areas in Kenya. We as flower growers and flower sellers may be a bit more fortunate because we at least have some cover above our heads, but believe me, the challenges for the farmers, the people really in the field with the dramatic climate changes and out is frightening sometimes. And when you meet a grower there being for 20, 25 years, a grower in the Lake Naivasha area, and who usually would know in the morning how the weather in the evening will be, and now he or she is just confused because everything is not as it has been for decades. So this is partly frightening. However, we can and we must act. We are the people, you know, even that we can afford sitting here in an afternoon looking to a screen, and that we don't have to care about what we have to eat in the evening and to drink for our family. This is a privilege, and our conviction is that we have to use this, this privilege to change things and to confront ourselves with the challenges. So I see preparing for this as I also what was asked by Melanie Dürr, who is taking care for fair trade for the cut flower segment, trying to find parallels also to other industries. I see dramatic challenges in the world of logistics. We have seen in Kenya dramatic increases of air freight cost. Of course, that is because there is more demand for air freight. And this is also, we have to admit, because the capacities in air freight worldwide to Africa were reduced only shortly before COVID. So COVID only gave that a higher speed because it was not worth anymore for many airlines going south, going from Africa to Europe, because they did not have any southbound freight. So that will be one of the big challenges also for governments, for the EU, to encourage and to support demand in Africa also for goods from the north, so that it is affordable again for more airlines also going south and not going south empty. But in general, many of you will have seen that, and many of you will see that because of sea container being as far as 300% more costly than half a year ago, this will dramatically increase our cost for cardboard, plastics, everything. So there's pressure from the market. And this is, it's a bit of deja vu for me, because when I joined this import industry 30 years ago, also it was difficult to get access from Africa to good logistics, to reliable logistics. But we have been in a period for 20 years now where it was a bit a party situation. We have been really offered very good services, and we may have taken that for granted, which we cannot continue to do. So I will try to give you possibly a way how you can tackle that. Then ethical quality and environmental quality of your products. A bit like tea, coffee, wine, fruit, vegetable, of course, also flowers are under the microscope from the supermarkets, which are the big buyers, which are taking 80% of the goods, the flowers produced in Africa. Concerning, firstly, in Germany, continental Europe, it was more the chemical residues, because there was this funny fear of the supermarket owners that flowers could stand on the German coffee table and then there would be this fog out of chemicals coming from Kenya or somewhere and then poison the whole family, which of course is nonsense. But of course, the whole thing now we learn and consumers learn more and more, it's connected with the world. So what we need, what we use as chemicals has to be produced. It will be somewhere. It will not just disappear. Workers will be exposed. Florists will be exposed, consumers possibly, and the nature and the water. there, I think in Africa, we have seen over the last two decades, huge progress. That that chemical usage in flowers, it's not that much nutrition, it's not that much fertilizer, it's more insecticides and fungicides. This has been reduced dramatically, but because of the new challenges of the climate change also, we are back at start. We have to see that we do not know how the coming years will develop, and we may lose all we have gained over the last 10, 15 years. And the other thing is, which is not new, but was more for the last 10, 15 years at the headlines in the UK, in the English speaking countries, which is the labor conditions and the ethical conditions, the social conditions of the workers. In the UK, the chemical residues are not that much in the foreground. But there, of course, now this is with extremely high speed. The supermarkets want to take into action and into reality what consumers, what NGOs, and what the media, and what also politicians demand, which is, if we can go back to the slide, I don't know whether you still see it, which will even be put, these labor conditions and the social conditions under which products are produced will, and that's the prognosis from my side, will even be part of new non-tariff based import barriers. This is something where we will see an alliance of people who want the good and know we need to put some pressure on decision makers, and others who may want to safeguard their interest in the local production markets, because then they can get rid of this. Now coming to the last column, I don't know, do you still see the slides? I see myself, which is a bit boring to me.
No, but you just go ahead. Go ahead, maybe a technical.
But what's the momentum now? I think, and this may be not very comfortable for you. We cannot complain about consumers not knowing how important it is to produce environmentally and socially, ethically fair. They know and they want. The demand is there. Never ever in history before there was so much knowledge available. Never ever so many people found access to that knowledge. And never ever so many, specifically people of the future, young people, people, let's say younger than 45, have taken that on board. They want to act as consumers fairly. They want to do that. And they are also prepared to pay more money for it. And I think they are prepared to pay, if it comes to our products, which are agricultural, horticultural products, they are prepared to pay a fair and an acceptable higher price for it. So the price is not the problem. As Nicola just mentioned, yes, the consumer, we always have to see what the consumer wants. However, unfortunately, very often, the consumer is not the gatekeeper to the market, it's the decision makers in the supermarkets. So therefore, I think we need some kind of alignment in trying to convince these supermarket organizations and to show them that development overall worldwide will just run over them if they don't act. So how can I sell more? Some of our partners ask me. Of course, I can say, well, then sell cheaper, you will sell more. But that's, as we just saw with cost increases and all these roadblocks, is not the solution. But it's up to everybody in his and her market. I'm still, despite the fact that we have international organizations, we have blockchain, we have systems, we have strategies, I'm still convinced in our horticultural, agricultural products, personal relationship and close cooperation is essential to create a good and stabilized, sustainable business. You need to know your customer, which is the exporter, the supermarket, or whatsoever. So, and you have to partner with them in some kind of way. The other thing, which I now with I'm in flower industry for something like 45 years now, what I learned is if you are not important for your customer, and if the customer is not important for me, then you cannot create value. It's impossible. There need to be a certain, I wouldn't call it dependence, but importance for each other, respect. The basis for a good business relationship, to my experience, for a good one, is respect. Respect does not mean that I have to accept everything my partner does. If a farmer says, I want to start a pineapple production in Iceland, I may say, oh, well, go ahead, but then without me. However, if I can support difficulties, which are just there for a certain time and we can bridge time, then I will do that if the supplier is important for me. So my advice is how I can sell more, focus rather on a lower number, a smaller number on partners, and do that well instead of just throwing your product around the world. And also find out how important are you for your customer, for the marketer, for the export company, because only this will put yourself into a position where you know how you can pull your weight and how you strategically can develop. That's something you can do very actively. The other thing, unfortunately, I must confess, you just have to behave. It's complying with the rules of the market, which is chemicals just that which are allowed in the market, the amount of many chemicals, the category of chemicals, just what is allowed. If, and that's also a learning I have, if there are extraordinary circumstances which force you to break these rules. Very often when you inform your partners about it, look, this is coming up, or this came up yesterday, we have to do something, otherwise we lose the entire crop. And when you're talking about roses, it's not that you say, okay, I lose this crop, then I put new seeds in, and in 3 weeks' time, I start newly. No, you have plants in, which you usually think you can work on for 7-8 years. Then it's ruined. Then your whole production is ruined. So mostly supermarket buyers and decision makers, if they are good partners and if they value you, and you, if you are important for them, they will never admit that you're important for them, by the way, but sometimes you are. Because there are always too many flowers around in the world, but flowers to earn money with for a supermarket are always short in supply. So therefore, if you have a good product, if you're important for them, they will allow you for some exemptions if you have to use certain chemicals, as long as you do it very transparently. So it's not that it's just a one-way dead-end road. But the other thing is you need to care also, and I think one of the speakers before mentioned quality. Quality is these ethical quality areas, it's the environmental quality, but of course it's the quality of a product itself. Frankly speaking, this is a given. Without that, you don't have any place in this modern world anymore. If your quality is in comparison to the other product, I don't say the competing product, because for me, flowers are not competing flowers. Mobile phones and traveling and nice food or wine also, this is competition for flowers, because this is where people spend money, disposable income, but it's not flowers. But you need to compare your flowers with flowers from others, and there you need to meet certain quality levels. If you can't do that, then with or without fair trade, you're done, frankly speaking. But also, what is more and more important when we are talking about transparency is the logistics, the communication, and the documentation. This sounds now very boring, but this is the essential. Without that, everything is nothing. And again, the logistics is important. In logistics, I will also come back to that later. I think that is more important now that you take care of that than it has been maybe 2 years ago. And this may be the same in wine from from Australia or from South Africa or wherever, because there is other goods which for which are by far more costly per unit or per ton or per liter or per cubic meter. And for them, it doesn't matter that much whether they pay €3 or €4 per kilo in air freight. But for us, it's live or die if we pay 180 or 210. And that is something where agricultural products are always losing out with the high technological products. And then please, we have to accept this is non-negotiable anymore. You cannot, because of your blue eyes, because of your, I don't know, difficult situation, because of my staff not having the money to buy a bicycle, you will not get away with this as an excuse for not complying with what I wrote above. Okay, then the next. I'm sounding like a preacher, isn't it? The next, please, sir.
Okay. Yeah, Jens, we know you're our bias. We're hearing it from the horse's mouth. We are the kind of people we need to learn. How do we get through? You know, what is it that we need to do? Is the next slide ready?
Yeah. So, I think you may ask, but who will pay for all of this? I have to take care of this and specialists and expertise and technology. Of course, there must be a fair share solution for this. Some will be on the right side to see it. I think the prices for agricultural and for horticultural product will have and will go up. Consumers will have to pay more for it. This will happen, but that's not the only solution. What I learned, just to give you a best practice possibly from our side, we are paying for the air freight for all cut flowers we buy in Kenya. So the air freight cost, we have an increase over the last 2 or 1.5 years of, in average, something like 35%. That was the, if we take the air freight cost, that was more than our profit we made. We, not 35% of the sales, but 35% of the air freight was more than, in total, our profit we made at the as a company. So, but we could not get any price increases from our customers. What we did is we just looked into our efficiency. We really again and again went through all processes. Paying the people less was no option, because also life here in Germany got more costly. There are less and less qualified people, so we also have to be attractive as an employer for them. So what we did is efficiency. And frankly speaking, I'm also coming from a third generation farmer, horticultural product. So I know we always think, oh, we are doing everything and we are so hardworking, but hardworking not always is clever working. So the farms need to be more efficient. That does not mean that your people have to work harder and quicker, but you need to introduce more technical developments from other industries. And you need, and that is something I think what is extremely important, you need to look into a better efficient production, because without that, our product will not survive. Use science and use technology. Be really revolutionary. Things, you know, had you asked me some things I do today, 2 years ago, I would have said never, ever. I don't touch that. I don't do that. Of course, now I'm doing them. I think that is very important. And I think I have it on the next slide. But I want to say, if in horticulture, do like the Dutch do. What do? They talk to each other. Different to Kenyans, they do not see. No, maybe you can go back. Maybe I have taken that out or in the next slide. So the Dutch is, you know, we have the big competition between, I think the Belgians also have that with the Dutch. So, but what we have to admit is they revolutionize our industry. They are developing and they are inventing all good things. They brought flowers to the consumers. They made flowers a real mainstream product. And why is that? It's because they also did not have too many other options. they don't have coal, they don't have gold, they don't have sun too much like the Mediterranean, but they are talking to each other. They don't see the farmer next door as their competitor. They see him, her as a colleague, and they align with each other and they align forces to get science and technology bringing their industry forward. But this is for the specific Dutch production situation. That's not necessarily for the Kenyan, which is totally different. So what I miss in the most fair trade countries, growing countries, producing countries, is better cooperation between the farmers, between the families, between the different companies to improve the position of the industry again against the competition, which is not flowers, which is not wine for wine, which is other goods which can be produced industrially cheaper than we can. So then we possibly can go to the, and also on the right side, you see the other thing we did is to make up the cost increases is we went by far more into niches. 5 years ago, we were not able to sell ready-made bouquets of flowers in Kenya made to German or to European supermarkets. Now we do, and with great progress and with good added value, also for the farms, that's fantastic because their workers, of course, like more to make a nice bouquet than just putting 10 stems like an industry robot into a bunch. So that's a win-win. So you get a bit out of the comparability of prices. So maybe then we can go to the next page and then I try to speed up. It's now a bit repeating. So another thing I also discussed with Melanie when we discussed what can a farm really do and where do we see improvements? You know, we are a company here as Omniflora. We have 80 employees. We do something like 50 million euro turnover. We do 180 million stems of flowers. In that, we are not that small. We are one of the biggest fair trade, and it's 90% fair trade flowers. In Germany, we are the biggest. And then we have our Dutch neighbors where you find five or six companies which are bigger. But in fair trade, there is just one company bigger and size is not important. But even with that, we are just small. We are nothing in the world of marketing, of PR, of new media. We are just too small. And I'm old. You know, I will turn 61. I will never be good in spreading our good news in this new world of communication and public relation. What I see sometimes when I visit a farm in Africa are nice tries. Then people show me a nice leaflet about the farm, telling a story. But frankly speaking, I don't need that. I know the farm. And frankly speaking, also sometimes it's a nice try, but it does not meet the requirements of the young generation. So what I want to say is fair trade, I must say in Germany is excellent in that. There's hardly any PR campaigning in Germany, which I think is as good as it is from fair trade. And that's one of the reasons why big supermarkets who do not like to have brands like fair trade in their shop because they want to have their own brands, but they have to admit Fairtrade has a good branding. And Fairtrade does that very well. Fairtrade has an extremely high acknowledgement of what consumers think that Fairtrade is fair. And therefore, they have to live with Fairtrade. But that shows Fairtrade is a PR professional. We are not. So use the Fairtrade organization also for support in your own PR. And then also what you can do is just get some youngsters on board and let them do something which may sound crazy to you, but in this world, it is essential that people recognize you. You have to be recognized. And then to give you one example, we are, our main customer in Germany is the Rewe Group, which is one of the biggest European supermarket groups. We are, if it comes to their buying value, I think we are between number as a supplier, 1,500 and 1,600 something. This is our ranking. But everybody in the board of director knows the fair trade flour company Omniflora. It was not necessary so far to call one of those in difficult situations, but I'm pretty sure if something would go wrong and I had the feeling we would not be treated fairly by the organization, then I could have a call and this would possibly be helpful. So this is because of personal relationship and so on, but also because of PR we did also with the support of Fairtrade. That is very grateful. And you as farmers or as Kenyan growers, do it as Kenyan growers, as Kenyan Fairtrade growers together as a group. Do it together. You should do something and you also should demand it from Fairtrade. And as the present world is one of data, of communication, of new media, as I said, give it on to professionals. Must be young people knowing how they play this piano. I don't know. And most of us also do not know. And we don't have the time. When the weather changes, then you know you have to go to your field and take care about your growing. And you cannot take care about some strategy in PR. That does not work. So last but not least, please. The last one, I think there I have the Dutch. I fit in the Dutch, I'm not sure. So not to be part of the problem, but to be part of the solution. This is, I think, our goal. But you yourself, I think there are decision makers here in this meeting. You cannot turn around and say, hey, somebody else should. You need to do it. And you need to do it today. So in logistics, my suggestion is, we have in this COVID crisis, specifically in March and May, the European Mother's Day, which is one, the continental, which is one of the most important sales days with big volumes, maybe two and a half times the volumes of normal weeks. Last year and this year, air freight space was not there, but we got the space. Not because we were running around with a checkbook or giving people dollars, because we had proven to our partners that we continuously gave them volume throughout the year, 12 months a year. So if you want to succeed in this world of logistics, don't hop around. Try to be consistent and continuously supply your partners with flowers and partner with ones who are strong in that. And that I think is the same with other goods. You need to be very close to your logistics partners or to the one with whom you share the logistics. The ethical quality. Many fair trade farms in Kenya in flowers had a huge advantage, that's the same in environmental growing, versus the conventional flower farms. We lost that. Most of the conventional flower farms also are doing quite a good job meanwhile, which is good for the environment, which is good for the product, which is good for the people. However, we as fair trade should try to be better. We should try to be at the forefront of this development, and we should not just do what is expected, we should do more than what is expected. Be a good example. And if there are owners or if there are cooperative heads of cooperatives here, if you do not embrace this conviction, if you think I do it because I have to do it, it's another order I have to do by the government or by EU, then this will not work. You have really to embrace it. The same is for the flowers. And there I put in when in flowers do like the Dutch do. There's a lot you can and we can learn from the Dutch, how they cooperate, how they open up, how transparent they are within their group. And that also can be done in your groups. So it's up to you to set up the course for your company, for your cooperative, for your organization. Now is the moment. And so start today. Thank you.
Wow, fantastic. You've given us so much. And but what I'm really hearing is also the share of the wallet, as you would say. So as you're going into the supermarket, I have so many needs. So will it be the flowers, will it be the coffee, is it the airtime? So we really have to ensure that we have a compelling message and position it so that then consumers are able to pick us. But there's also a question which I hope we can come to later. How do we communicate to our retailers, to our buyers about the consumer needs So it's just not really subjective in terms of, fair trade or I don't, you know, but it is a consumer demand. And you really brought out the issues of relationship selling, and that is what fair trade is, building relationships, lobbying and advocacy. A lot of people in the chat are talking about that, that as fair trade, we still need to do a lot more. And I think that is where the campaigns on consumption, sustainable consumption and trade comes in.
If I may, if I may add one thing, there was the colleague, the Spanish-speaking colleague, sorry for not remembering name, and he said, well, how do I get, as a small cooperative, how do I get to the market and so on? I think you really, you need to focus and you need to, to build up relationship to people in the market. Frankly speaking, the supermarket buyer, who anyhow, possibly in half a year's time, may be a different person. This is not the important step. Leave the marketing and the promotion of fair trade to fair trade, but get a link to somebody in the market selling your product to the supermarket. This may not be your exporter. You need to create some kind of pull function. There needs to be some pull from the market, as you cannot reach the consumer directly, as it's unlikely that you reach the supermarket, then try to get somebody in the market, an importer or whatsoever, to fight and to work for your product and for your company and for the stories of your company. The momentum I mentioned is, and despite the difficult times the world is in, unfortunately, these crisis times when people are looking for security and for good things, for nice things, for beautiful things, the fair trade products are more demanded than ever. So we have it in our hands.
Yeah, I think there's still a lot more we still need to do. We are selling about 20-25% of fair trade flowers on fair trade terms. So I believe this is a conversation and some of the things that you have told us about the impact stories, the branding, really involving the youth and the new innovative ideas in terms of selling that we need to put. And of course, consumer is always key. The consumer will always be king. They say we jump, we say we ask how high. But even as we're doing that is to ensure that we are doing it a lot more effectively. Ethical quality has really come up across all the speakers. Quality is extremely key. But then how do you deliver that quality at a sustainable and a sustainable price? Affordable is another discussion on its own. We'll do a quick poll. Kubasa, I hope you're ready. We want to hear from the attendees in terms of, in your opinion, what are the things that we need to do? We've heard from our speakers, but we want to hear from the attendees. In your opinion, what is the one thing that Fairtrade Africa should prioritize to increase market access for its producers? What is the one thing that we need to do? We've heard from our panelists, we've heard from Hens about quality, we've heard about the consumer, we've heard about relationships, but from the fair trade, from the attendees, what is the one thing that we need to do as fair trade? So that even as Fair Trade Africa, we're walking away with some of the things that we need to hear. We've heard from the buyer, that was quite interesting. We've heard from the buying markets. We've heard from the small and large producers. But let's hear from the audience. Kubasa, how much time do we have for the poll? We are right at the top of the hour. We're meant to be concluding now, but I ask for your indulgence, not more than 15 minutes. We started the session about 15 minutes behind schedule. If you could just give us those 15 minutes so that then we can just wrap up. and have really concrete takeaways that we can implement as we design our access to markets. So we have about 36% who have voted. If you could get at least 50%, if not 70% of you, we are close to 50% now, and we can close in another 30 seconds. In your opinion, what is the one thing that Fairtrade Africa should prioritize to increase market access for its producers? We're here because of our producers. In 2040, there'll be about 2 billion Africans, and in the world in 2050, it'll be about 9 billion. And you heard from Norman, our youth representative, a third of those will be the youth and they'll be in Africa. So really we need to ensure that we are strengthening what we are doing in the market. And we also have the challenge of aging farmers. Our average farm age is about 50 to 60. So we really need to ensure that the youth are in this agricultural space, which contributes at least 25% of the GDP. I think we can close now. What are the results, Kubasu? What are people feeling? Where are their minds? And let's see if our panelists. Can wrap up. What are the results, Kubasu? As the results come, our panelists, the last question as we wrap up is in terms of our offer to business as fair trade and also as producers. What improvements would you suggest that we should put? I'm getting very good comments that the session was extremely informative. Very tangible takeouts that we can actually go out and implement. And there we go, we get the results. Marketing approaches, which would include visibility. Somebody asked about visibility. So marketing approaches has really come up top in terms of the things that we need to prioritize. So it is how we communicate. And that's what we're talking about, the PR, the lobbying, the advocacy, that we need to ensure that we've prioritized as the producers then are able to match the market. And the one that has come very closely also as number two is a value addition. Maybe not as closely, but number two is a value addition. So again, our producers have been producing and we export a lot of our products as raw products or semi-processed products. And all that product, most of it will come back value added elsewhere. So again, that is another opportunity that the producers see. But I think it's pretty clear and it was the same message across in terms of marketing and ensuring that we are able to deliver what the consumer needs and to communicate our impact. Thank you very much. So just as to wrap up very quickly in under a minute, everybody, we will start with you, Ms. Hend, in terms of our offer to business. What do we need to do? How do we improve to close the market opportunities? Thank you, Kubasu.
I think what we need, as everybody said, is to be able to pull the product from Africa into the European markets where fair trade is visible. Something like the German market, for example, it's a very strong market, but the supermarkets and the buyers, and the buyers are not pulling for a reason of the premium. The premium, we have problems with the premium, is that it's a bit high, especially in bulk products like potatoes, where we are, for example, our company has been registered since 2017. For the last 4 years, we haven't sold 1 kilogram of fair trade potatoes, even though we were asked by our big supermarket in Germany to register fair trade. We tried to negotiate the premium. We gave discounts. We initially had an order of 20,000 tons of fair trade potatoes, for example, and then even before the COVID-19, and then because of the premium 15%, they said no. They wanted to lower it much more than this. So
Thank you.
Need to lobby with the supermarkets.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you, Ms. Hend. Premium is one of the areas you challenge us to look at. Mariana, any takeout in terms of our offer to business, in terms of increasing access? What do you think that we need to improve on?
Yes, I think from a wine perspective, very specifically, I don't think enough attention has been given to marketing wine in international markets. I do think wine has been left by the wayside quite significantly when it comes to fair trade. But I do know that the Fair Trade Africa team really are focusing on wine, promoting wine and positioning wine going forward. The minimum price does need to be revisited from a wine perspective, and I will be continuously working with the Fair Trade Africa team to ensure that wine gets a greater platform in international markets.
Fantastic. Thank you. And we'll definitely be working very closely with yourselves to ensure that we're increasing our market sales. And for the insights about the marketing of wine, and again, the minimum price comes in. Benitez, what aspects of our offer to business do you think we need to strengthen so that then we can increase access to market for coffee or any other product?
I'm sorry, can you say again the question, please?
The fair trade offer to business, what aspects of it do you think we need to improve so that we're able to increase access to market, in your opinion, from the coffee small produce organization?
I have some problem right now. I can hear you very well. Can you repeat, please? I'm sorry.
Any parting shots in terms of the things we need to do? Yeah. Any parting shots in terms of any strategies that we need to improve our access to market? And our Spanish interpretation is working, so you can speak in Spanish. Just 1 minute.
Okay. I have some problem right now with the sign.
We can hear you. Keep going.
Okay. I didn't hear very well the question because I have some problem with the sign. I'm sorry, but if you can repeat again.
Your parting shots. Give us your parting shot. What would you tell us as fair trade we need to pay attention to increase market access? And then we'll come to Nicholas and we finish with Jens.
Okay. For us, you know, in the coffee market is, you need to improve, you know, the way how you make the process, because right now the market is asking or looking for difference, you know, in the product. So for us, it's a little bit hard, you know. If you don't know what is the market, you know, looking for. So that is the reason that many organizations is very difficult for them to attend, you know, what the market is looking for. So that's the way that we try to improve, you know, and we attend some different fairs in the world to know about what the market is looking for. Also, it's very important for us to diversify, you know, our product, because you don't depend just for one of the, in our case, just for coffee, you know. We used to have some big problems with the rust, you know, that affected most of the plantation. So that made us to decrease our production. So that is how we are trying to diversify to improve, you know, our profit.
Yeah. So consumer needs, ensuring that we are meeting the consumer needs, and diversification, that is a very important point. Some of the things that we need to yes. embrace, so that we're able to increase our offer to business and relevance really in the market. Thank you, Benitez. Nicholas?
Okay.
Yes.
Any take out in terms of the things we need to tighten on our offer to business so that we're able to access more markets? 30 seconds.
I think it was said a few times. I think at the end of the day, it's about, you know, working together. And the good things is that, you know, before, our customers, they just wanted the label, and that was it. And they were not really interested in what was going on. And more and more they want to get involved for various reasons. So it's really an opportunity to build together, you know, with the customers, with the producers organization, to really build solutions together that will benefit everyone, and to get also increased impact for the farmers by doing so. But that requires really, you know, linking the dots. There is something we say in a fair trade in Belgium, and a kind of mantra we have, which is that human chains are stronger than supply chains. So I guess that's my call to action, or my dream is that we keep building this this human chain.
Yes. So the term that comes to mind is co-creation, and we do a lot of that when you're doing consumer campaigns, behavior campaigns. And that's a challenge you're giving us, to be able to co-create with our consumers, with our buyers, with our producers, so that you're able to meet the needs. Jens, I know you've told us quite a lot. I'm not sure if you have one parting shot in like one sentence.
30 seconds. I have two things. One is join forces with at least one or two you like and respect of your colleagues. And secondly, do good and let others talk about it. Give the PR and the marketing in the hands of professionals. That's it.
Okay, thank you. Again, very aligned to what our audience is saying in terms of communication and marketing. Thanks a lot. Thank you once again, our panelists, for making time to be able to be with us today and giving us such practical takeouts. Best practices that you have implemented in your different areas that we've picked up and we're going to implement both as fair trade and as our producer organization. And to the audience, all protocols observed, we say thank you for joining us this day on this the 7th Africa Fair Trade Convention. We've learned quite a lot, and it's only day one. So we encourage you to stay logged in on the platform, interact with the various aspects of the platform to see what's happening across the globe. At Fairtrade Africa, we are in 33 countries out of the 55 that are in the Fairtrade International System. So you can see how large we are spread and really impacting lives of about 1.2 million farmers. You put in plus their families, you're talking close to several millions. So please stay engaged, get into the virtual, into the platform, look at the videos. Join us tomorrow for other exciting sessions. My next speaker, I think, will be Peter. Around the same time, we'll be also talking about investments. What kind of investments do we need to put in to increase on our market access? So thank you very, very much. Any unanswered questions, we have picked those and we'll be able to continue talking on the chat, on the platform, I'll answer those. We also had questions about cashew nut farmers. We have commercial managers who are on the call. They have picked up any questions that are market related, and they're going to follow up with each one of you with responses and correct linkages. So I must say thank you very much. Do have a great day or a great evening from wherever you may be calling from. My name once again is Kate Nkatha. I'm the commercial director, and I'm happy to engage with each of you on the platform and beyond. Thank you very much.
Thank you.